Hello and welcome to the latest presentation of the Rift Valley Webinar Series. My name is Richard Griscom and I am the host for today's talk. If you are participating in the live webinar, you can submit questions or comments in the chat window of the Zoom application at any time during the presentation, or you can use the raise hand function in the participants window if you would like to contribute a comment or question using your microphone after the presentation has finished. Today's speaker is Jeremy Coburn. Jeremy is a PhD candidate at Indiana University, pursuing a PhD in linguistics with a concentration on African languages and linguistics. His research interests include the documentation and description of languages in Tanzania, which currently include Hadza, which he's been doing since 2017, and Swahili. Jeremy's research employs instrumentation and laboratory techniques, including a novel 3D and 4D ultrasound methodology for speech production to explore phonetic and phonological phenomena. He will be focusing on the description of Hadza phonetics and phonology for his doctoral dissertation. Please join me in welcoming Jeremy as he gives his presentation, Hadza Phonetics 3D, 4D Ultrasound and Other Instrumental Analyses.
All right. Thank you very much, Richard, for that introduction. And welcome everyone to this instantiation of the Rift Valley Network webinar series. I appreciate you guys being with me. Let me begin first by saying that I've been confined to my home for long periods of time, and I've recently realized that my internet connection is not as great as it should be. And so hopefully we don't encounter any issues with the connection between me and you. With that said, I also hope that you all are doing well wherever you are, given the circumstances at this time. Today I will be presenting on, as was introduced, Hadza Phonetics. And the purpose of this talk is largely going to be methodological. At this time, this presentation and this project is largely experimental and in its infancy. It is my hope that as I present some of the methodology and some of the preliminary findings, that hopefully we can have a good discussion at the end of the presentation. And if you have any thoughts or suggestions or critiques or any of those types of things, I would greatly appreciate them as we continue to move forward as we look at Hadza Phonetics. I look forward to giving this presentation to contribute to a growing series of talks on Hadza within the Rift Valley Network webinar series. The first one that started out this webinar series was a presentation I gave a while back called A Critical Evaluation of Hadza Language Use and Maintenance Efforts. And then that talk was followed by presentations by Amani Lusekelo, one on the human context and societal changes, the case of personal names of Hadzabe and linguistic aspects of names of crops and plants in Hadzabe. As well as, I know there have been other conversations and discussions and presentations with reference to Hadza, but I look forward to contributing to that conversation now. So a little bit about my background. I currently reside in Indiana. I am a PhD candidate, as I was introduced, at Indiana University, and my focus is largely on African languages and linguistics. I do have a minor as well in anthropology, so I do have some interests in cultural aspects of this, but largely my focus is on phonetics and phonology. This is actually a picture here of the last time that I was visiting the Hadza, and staying with Mariam Wanyawire, who is a well-known Hadza consultant. This was from a trip where I was able to establish connections preparatory for my dissertation research, which will hopefully be happening sometime next year. I have been awarded a Fulbright Hayes Doctoral Dissertation Research Abroad Fellowship to conduct my dissertation research with the Hadza in Tanzania. But obviously, plans and things are fluid at this time, and we just hope that things will be able to move forward as planned. I know that many of you are aware of the Hadza, who they are, where they come from, some of their history. And if you want more of an in-depth discussion of this, I would refer you to my earlier presentation. But just a brief background on who the Hadza are for those who may not be familiar. The Hadza, or Hadzabe, as you'll hear me call them interchangeably during this presentation, are an autochthonous ethnic group residing in north central Tanzania around Lake Eyasi. Many of them still live or practice a hunter-gatherer lifestyle, though not all. And they speak a language which is considered to be a linguistic isolate, meaning that it has not been shown to be genetically related to any other languages. That makes it very interesting. It also is interesting because it is one of the, you know, so many languages in the world that make use of click consonants, which is largely probably what drew me to Hadza in the initial stages as I was looking for my research interests as an undergraduate. The population estimates for the Hadza are actually quite diverse. The most common estimates are approximately around 1,000 speakers of Hadza. This is according, in this case, Blurt and Jones 2016, as well as many others who have made this assertion. But there is also the Languages of Tanzania project that looked at the demography for the Hadza asserts that there is maybe actually as many as 6,289 Hadza individuals. This is based on their count from 2009. It is not, I take no stance on this at this time, but these are the estimates that have been made for the population. So a brief history of the research that has gone on with the Hadza. There's an extensive anthropological literature. I'm not going to get into that at this time. If you're interested in seeing that research, you can refer to the Rift Valley Bibliography by Griscom and Harvey 2020 to be able to see more of that research. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the linguistic research and what has been said about the linguistics of Hadza in the past. And this largely began with linguistic-ish research done by Tucker, Bryan, and Woodburn, 1977. This was the paper, the East African Click Languages, a phonetic comparison, where they compared Hadza, Sandawe, and Dahalo. The Hadza portion of this paper was in collaboration with James Woodburn, who had done extensive field work with the Hadza, but was himself an anthropologist, not a linguist, but was reportedly fluent in the language, and so consulted with Tucker and Bryan to write this portion. The paper does make mention of, you know, consonants and vowels and reported contrasts. However, this was quite early, and as I said, Woodburn was not himself a linguist. So then instrumental phonetic research was conducted by Bonnie Sands, Ian Maddieson, and Peter Ladefoged in the early 1990s, where they went and met with the Hadza and collected recordings and palatography and conducted lingography research. And the results of this research can be found in Sands et al. 1996, entitled The Phonetic Structures of Hadza, as well as in Ladefoged and Maddieson's now famous book, The Sounds of the World's Languages, which is a very in-depth discussion of many of the sounds that are produced all around the world. There are quite a number of references to Hadza, especially within the click section of that book, that discuss some of the differences between clicks as produced by Hadza speakers as opposed to clicks as produced by Khoisan speakers. Also another one that was more recently published, though I believe Bonnie would say that this was largely written much earlier than this, is Sands 2013, the chapter Phonetics and Phonology Hadza, where she talks about the sound system that we find in Hadza. the phonetic structures of Hadza, the 1996 paper by Bonnie, Ian, and Peter, is at this point really the most definitive and extensive phonetic research that has been conducted on Hadza. And it went into a lot of the phenomena that may be of interest within the Hadza sound system. And since that time, nothing has really been done in terms of looking at the Hadza phonetics. There have been reports and literature written since then, but nothing that has looked instrumentally at some of the more enigmatic phenomena that we see within Hadza. There are some other more recent research that has been conducted. A lot of this was done by Kirk Miller. And so there, you know, in things such as Miller 2008, Hadza grammar notes that reports and in fact reports some things which are not seen previously in some of the earlier literature, such as in the phonetic structures of Hadza. So this leads to some open questions that exist and some debates that have existed in the literature that have not yet been answered. And some of these open questions that are being explored right now are one, the number of consonants in the phoneme inventory. When referring back now to the Tucker, Bryan, and Woodburn earlier article, they report that there is, in fact, I believe it is four clicks referring to the dental, an alveolar, and the lateral, but then also some sort of flapped click, which they transcribe as two exclamation points. Then in Sands et al. 1996, the flapped alveolar click is reported to actually be just the same, one and the same with the regular alveolar click, but then also adds that there is some cases of a bilabial click being found, and so that also reports four, though the number of click accompaniments that are found there are obviously much more extensive in the Sands article, Sands et al. 1996. In fact, the status of aspiration contrasts within Hadza is something that it continues to be an interesting topic of discussion. In Sands et al. 1996, Bonnie, Ian, and Peter report that there is no aspiration contrast in clicks. However, in Miller 2008 and other publications, he suggests that there is, in fact, an aspiration contrast in clicks and affricates. And so the actual status of this is currently not been explored phonetically and proven phonetically, just been reported. And so this is something that is interesting and something that needs to be explored further. The other issue is currently the analysis of prenasalized consonants and nasals in general in Hadza, whether these are in fact prenasalized consonants or NC sequences, or what exactly the status of these consonants may be. Another thing that there is a bit of discrepancy within the available literature at this time is in the characteristics of some consonants. For example, in many publications, it has been reported that Hadza has a velar ejective, stop ejective, whereas in many of Miller's publications, it is reported as, in fact, an ejective affricate, a velar affricate. And then also the status of the articulation of the what has been reported as a palatal lateral affricate or an alveolar lateral affricate. This is still an open debate that needs to be solved through more in-depth phonetic investigation. There's also issues related to the glottals, the glottal stop, and the glottal fricative, what exactly they are and how they are exhibited within the language is something that is yet to be further explored. There's also an issue of the prosodic characteristics and typology of Hadza. The earlier report by Tucker, Woodburn, and Bryan claim that Hadza is in fact tonal, and they note three distinctive tonal or pitch heights. However, this is later disputed by Sands et al. 1996 in saying that it is not currently clear whether there is in fact contrastive tone or whether that we're actually dealing something with more that is pitch accent. So this is something that needs to be better investigated. So some of the current research directions, what's happening now to expand the phonetic documentation of Hadza is there are documentation projects ongoing, one of them being Griscom and Harvey 2020, where they are creating a large archive of Hadza recordings to bring up the level of language documentation of Hadza to meet some of the demands, some of the needs in order to more greatly expand the available research and workings on Hadza. There has also been a recently conducted phonetic data collection project that was conducted by Didier Desmoulins, Richard Griscom, Andrew Harvey, Alain Guillot, and Roland Kiesling, where they went and spent some time with the Hadza and a few other ethnic groups in the Rift Valley to collect phonetic data. And the data that they did collect was aerodynamic data, using EGG, HD, high definition video, and palatography to start to collect some more data on the phonetics of Hadza. And this data is currently being worked through. DDA is still working on it, but it is our hope that at some point in the near future, it will be available to where we can start using it for to analyze it. Another really interesting project that's going on right now involves Andrew Harvey, Richard Griscom, and myself, with also working with Bonnie Sands, DDA, and Kirk Miller, is we are currently working on an article to be included in the illustrations of the IPA articles that is published by the Journal of the International Phonetic Association, or JIPA. Within this paper, we are exploring a number of phenomena, especially those that I've already mentioned that are of interest, the nature of aspiration and aspiration contrast within Hadza, looking at characterizing quantitatively and qualitatively the vowel system, the nature of the click contrast, the accompaniments, and many other interesting phenomena that are open questions that we are still exploring at this time. We are hoping to be able to answer in our illustration of the IPA paper. And so that will be forthcoming, hopefully. Then there's also a project that I personally conducted and am still working through the data on, because I actually collected data the week before everything shut down in the United States due to the coronavirus pandemic. But I was able to get a speaker of Hadza to come and visit me on campus at Indiana University to collect 3D, 4D ultrasound data with him using our ultrasound machine here. And we hope that as I work through this data, that this will contribute significantly to the articulatory data that is available on Hadza. To talk a little bit more about that specific project, because this is where this is kind of new territory that has not been explored. I'm just going to talk a little bit more about this 3D 4D ultrasound methodology. Again, this is a new project. It's something that we have never actually used for exploring things such as clicks or ejectives, anything like that. And so it is still largely exploratory, and I would welcome any comments or questions that people have about this after I present it. But currently at Indiana University, we have a 3D 4D ultrasound machine that has been set up and established for speech science research. We are currently the only such machine that is available in work and working in the world to be able to collect 3D 4D ultrasound for speech research. And so there are many things that we're still exploring, but in terms of the data collection and the way that this methodology works is we create a digitized palate impression using hypoallergenic dental alginate, which has been described in the by Ladefoged in some of his, and I think Phonetic Data Analysis book. And then we use that palette impression and scan it using a next engine desktop 3D scanner to digitize it and be able to put it within the computer system. We then use real-time 3D ultrasonography using a Philips ultrasound machine and a 3D 4D transducer. And we secure the transducer to the participant's head using an articulate instruments limited headset in order to reduce movement of the transducer during speech production. For this specific project, and based on the way that we, the parameters that we set for the machine in order to maximize its output, we were able to obtain a frame rate of 17 frames per second for this specific project. Though on past projects that I've worked also on Zulu, for example, and we were able to get some quicker frame rates up to 23 frames per second, but we had to sacrifice the spatial resolution. And so for this one where we wanted to have as much as possible, we increased the frame rates by, or decreased the frame rates by increasing the spatial resolution. And at the same time as collecting the articulatory data using the ultrasound, we also collected acoustic data using a synchronous audio signal collection using a microphone. And the speaker was seated in a sound attenuating room at the time. Then once the data is collected, what we do to actually analyze this data that has all been collected is we use a custom MATLAB toolbox called WASL that has been created by Professor Stephen Lulich in the Department of Speech and Hearing Sciences at Indiana University. And what this toolbox allows us to do is to load the ultrasound, audio, and palette data and synchronize them in order to be able to analyze things together. This also allows the user to create 3D reconstructions of the tongue surface via manual tracing. And what that looks like is here is actually an image of the WASL interface in MATLAB. And as you can see from this image, as I briefly explained through it, the large box in the center, top center, is the sagittal plane. The smaller box below it is the coronal plane, and the box on the bottom right is the transverse plane or horizontal plane, looking at the tongue during speech production. This is the Hadza speaker producing the a nasalized alveolar click na in the word na na, and this is at the moment just prior to two frames before release of that click. So this is probably the onset of the rarefaction gesture, and as you can see in the top right corner, we are able to trace these images manually based on what we see in the ultrasound data and create grids, which are then interpolated in order for us to have the 3D reconstructions of the tongue. Here is an example of what this can look like. In this case, this is actually overlaid 3D tongue traces of Hadza vowels for this speaker, one token of each vowel, one instance of each vowel for this speaker, laid over each other so that you can compare the articulation of each vowel. And in this case, the high front vowel is in pink, the blue is the mid front vowel, the high back vowel is in salmon or red, and the mid back vowel is in green, and the low vowel is in yellow. And what this 3D 4D ultrasound allows us to do in terms of phonetic documentation and description is it allows us to actually show articulation of things which were largely described using only acoustic means. In this case, we are able to show the articulation of Hadza vowels for this speaker, whereas before it would have largely only been shown using formant measures F1, F2. Now we're able to actually show this articulatorily. Now it should be noted that of course this is only one repetition for each vowel for this specific speaker, and so of course there will be variation. What is also very interesting and exciting about this methodology is we can In fact, after we have created tracings for, you know, so many productions of a specific vowel, we can actually create an average tracing for that vowel to create an averaged vowel production for a specific speaker. And then even across speakers, we can do the same so that we can actually get a data-rich description and figure which shows Hadza vowels largely. At this time, obviously, we only had the one speaker, so that was this is what we were able to work with at that point. The other thing which is quite exciting about the 3D 4D ultrasound is that because it is, in fact, 4D, the fourth dimension being time, we are able to look at productions of 3D productions also across the temporal plane. So in this case, what you're actually looking at in this figure is a click articulation. This is the what has been called alveolar or post-alveolar click in two separate frames. So in the orange, this is frame one. This is probably three frames before the click release, maybe two frames. I can't remember exactly for this specific figure, but it is the orange is one frame and blue is the frame just following. So what we're actually seeing is this rarefaction gesture with tongue tip being raised and the tongue body being retracted. So we're able to look at different phases of click articulation and click production using this 3D information. Now, obviously, one of the limitations of this is many of you may find this difficult to look at because you're not used to looking at 3D ultrasound images, obviously. And so one of the challenges that we face with using this is actually how to present this data in a way that is digestible by interested, you know, researchers. And I should also mention that in this case, we do have the palette overlay, and that is the clear overlay here, so that we can actually see where the tongue is being articulated, or where the consonant is being articulated along the palate. The other limitation, which of course is a significant drawback of this technology, is currently that we are the only speech lab to have access to 3D ultrasound, 3D 4D ultrasound for speech science. And the nature of the instrument makes it that it is so that it is unable to be moved outside of the lab. So it is not portable enough to be able to take into a field situation. Obviously, we hope that as technology continues to advance, that ability will become available. Otherwise, you know, it is reliant on us being able to bring speakers to us, which is obviously difficult, especially at this time. But what we are able to obtain in terms of information and data about the speakers from even this one speaker is quite interesting and is exciting for being able to better describe and document the phonetics of Hadza. And adding to that articulatory data that is spatially and temporally rich is quite an exciting contribution of this data. I'd like to finish this talk by saying that, as I said, this is exploratory. I would love to hear any thoughts or suggestions on directions that this could be taken. There are other projects in process, as I had mentioned, that we are currently exploring, especially with the illustration of the IPA paper, that will hopefully contribute a great deal to our understanding of Hadza phonetics, as well as my own dissertation research, which I will be hopefully conducting next year at some point, hopefully sometime early next year, be able to go and conduct more in-depth instrumental analyses with the Hadzabe on the Hadza language. And then we can be able to see how our knowledge and understanding of this language can move forward at that time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeremy, for your presentation. I think we can now begin the question and answer section. If anyone would like to ask a question or offer a comment, you can do so using the Zoom chat window or by using the raise hand function in the participants window. I will start with my own question to give other participants time to write or prepare their question or comment. So first, I just want to say the data that you just showed was really fascinating. I have a couple of ideas or questions about the method or the process for producing this data. Mm-hmm. So my first question concerning the different frames of a single production, is it possible to reconstruct or create a video or an animation of some kind of the articulations by manually contouring each frame of the production or the articulation?
Yes, of course. That definitely is something that I am interested in, though I have not currently done. But yeah, it should be fairly straightforward to be able to create animations of this production. Part of the issue, though, with that is that because of the frame rates, you know, the change in tongue contour between one frame and the next may be quite large, especially in cases with like Hadza or in clicks like in Hadza, where they are quite rapid. They involve a great deal of articulatory complexity and multiple articulations. So that makes it a little bit difficult at this time with the current frame rates to be able to do something that would be satisfying, at least to my mind. One thing that is interesting is I'm currently working with a researcher out of Singapore named Scott Moisek, who works in biomechanical modeling. And we are trying to put this data into his articulation models to see if we can reproduce click production in 3D, you know, in an animation. So that is something that we are exploring, though we currently haven't been able to produce anything yet. Because as I said, all this was collected right as everything kind of hit the fan, as they say.
Thanks, and I don't see any other comments or questions yet, so I'll continue with one of my own. I'm curious about the manual tracing. So you mentioned that there's a manual processing task that's involved in producing this data, and that's manually tracing the contour of the tongue. Yeah, as we see in the image on the bottom center. I'm curious if in the future there might be some way to automate this. The reason I'm thinking of this is because we've been working on forced alignment as well. And I imagine there might be a way to begin to automate this or to create some automated data that then can be manually edited using something like machine learning. If you have manually edited enough of these ultrasound images, then perhaps you could create a model that then could try to create its own contours, essentially, perhaps speeding up the process.
Yeah, that's actually, so first, I guess to answer the question, yeah, looking at this image, we're able to kind of see how the manual tracing works. If you're not familiar with ultrasound data, looking at, let's say, the sagittal plane here in the top center, we see the place where the blue essentially transitions to yellow. This line between what we're seeing there is the tongue surface as it transitions between an area of high density to an area of low density at the tongue surface. And what we do is we look at this image and we manually trace that to be able to trace the tongue surface. Now, I currently, because of the complexity of clicks, have basically only manually segmented and traced all of these because I don't trust the automated one. But there is, in fact, an automated tracing software available within this toolbox. In fact, if you look in the, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but if you look on the side, the left side within the window pane, there's a thing that's called 3D Slurp. And this program, as you run it, will actually automatically trace the tongue surface for you. Now, it's very effective as long as it is on a consonant or on a sound where the tongue is in a position that is quite easy for it to detect. In cases with clicks where you're having very small surface area that is not contacting the palate, makes it more difficult for the program to trace. So I actually do it manually. But the idea of using machine learning to basically change the manual segmentation and teach the automated segmentation is something I hadn't thought about, but is an interesting idea that I think is worth exploring. So thank you for that.
Yeah, thanks. So we've got a few questions here in the chat window from Richard Wright. He says, Asante sana kwa hotuba yako. There is some work now on trying to get further back in the pharynx to see the tongue root. Is this possible using this method?
That's an excellent question. It is possible. That was actually something that I wished I could have included in this project, but because I was particularly interested in the clicks, I was trying to maximize my temporal resolution, so I had to sacrifice some of the spatial resolution. But you can, in fact, extend the cone of the ultrasound image to include more of the tongue root. I don't know how far back we could expand the window, but we could also, with the headset, we can adjust the probe to lean it farther back to see more of the posterior portions of the tongue and the pharynx. So definitely we can do that. It is something that I would like to do, especially as more research is showing that there's very interesting things happening with the tongue root. In many cases, actually in Hadza, I don't think I have any images that show it interestingly here, but we are getting a lot of tongue grooving, what appears to be the very top of tongue grooving in the tongue root in the extreme posterior portions of the tongue that I think is worth exploring further using this methodology. So absolutely, Asante.
Thanks. And then we have a question from Alan Gill. It says, thank you. Do you think that portable ultrasound 2D plus time could be interesting to use in the field? And just as some background, I think DDA and Alan, they actually had planned to use an ultrasound machine in the field, but for one reason or another, it didn't work out. And now that you've done 3D or 4D ultrasound, what could 2D ultrasound still have to tell us?
That's an excellent question. The short answer is yes. I think that 2D ultrasound being used in the field is extremely beneficial and valuable information, because it allows us to work with people like the Hadza, much more difficult to get them into a laboratory situation than it is if you were working with, say, speakers of Southern Indiana English. So yes, I think it's very valuable to use it. And in fact, me and Didier have talked about whether we could potentially arrange something so that I could collect 2D ultrasound while we are there in the future. And I think that is definitely something that is planned. Now, with all of that said, I do want to make a point that is interesting that this 3D ultrasound allows us to do that is limited in 2D ultrasound. And that is, if you look at the image actually on this slide, the bottom middle in the coronal plane, what you're seeing is actually just to the right of the center dot, there is a line of yellow that's a somewhat vertical spot of yellow. That is likely the septum of the tongue, the midline of the tongue. And in this project, I think we were off of the midline, off the mid-sagittal by probably two sagittal slices. In my project with my Zulu speaker, we were 7 sagittal slices off of the midline, even though the person who was attaching the ultrasound transducer was highly trained in doing it. It is so difficult to align it perfectly with the midline. And that said, it also, there's just people who are asymmetrical inside. And so because of that, even though 2D ultrasound is valuable, and I do believe that it should be done, it should be remembered that there is always the possibility that what you are seeing is not in fact the midline or the mid-sagittal, or it also should always be remembered that what is happening off the midline is also interesting. And that's what this 3D methodology allows us to do, is to see, well, what is actually happening in the lateral margins of the tongue? And in cases like the lateral click, mid-sagittal slices just don't tell us very much, other than maybe where the anterior or posterior occlusions are, but not actually in terms of the production of it and the release properties of that sound. So there are limitations to the 2D ultrasound, obviously, but its portability is obviously a large gain over this, which is restricted to a single room in a single place.
Thanks. And then we have, a related question from Bonnie Sands. She asks, could you mention some of the asymmetries you've seen looking at the coronal plane?
Yes. So yes, I can mention that. And this is comes from conversations that Bonnie and I have had about this. It turns out, and I think there's actually a couple of, I'm trying to remember, a couple of articles about this specifically. I know there's one by Gill and others about asymmetrical tendencies of speakers, that speakers tend to produce things asymmetrically. And so with my Zulu speaker, for example, when I was collecting Zulu data, I actually found that the speaker was producing all of the clicks with a preference, a bias to the right side of her palate. And so the midline that we were seeing, which was already off on the initial, on when the tongue was at rest, was extremely off, I think by 13 sagittal slices when she was actually producing the click, because her tongue, she produces it asymmetrically. And so what this 3D ultrasound allows us to do is it allows us to see that, which is valuable in the sense that we get to know how asymmetrical speakers are, which is a significant contribution, but also allows us to still capture what is going on when in a 2D ultrasound, for example, what you would think was happening would be completely different than what was actually happening. Because in this case, by the time she produced the click, what we were seeing was actually the lateral margin of her tongue. And so it looked almost as if there was no click cavity being formed for the production of the click, because all we were seeing was basically a straight line. But that was actually because that was the lateral margin of her tongue that was being traced on the mid-sagittal. And we only knew that because of the 3D information. So.
Thanks. So I have a question of my own. It's a non-specialist. Seeing as this is one of the first research projects that's utilized 3D and 4D ultrasound, I'm curious if there was anything that you think you could improve on next time. So you mentioned the alignment. But anything else in terms of using this technology or designing the study?
In terms of designing the study, I can't think of anything specifically that I would have done differently from this case. I think what is probably worth mentioning is maybe some of the directions that this could be taken that I haven't mentioned already. With the Zulu speaker, what I was actually interested in was click accompaniment co-articulation or co-production. And this allows temporally rich 3D ultrasound data allows us to see some pretty interesting things in terms of co-articulation and make some interesting comparisons. And so what I intend to use some of this data for in the future is to look at how do clicks differ as they are produced with different so-called click accompaniments. That is, if a click is aspirated, how does the articulation differ from when it is unaspirated? Or when it is nasalized, how does it differ from when it is non-nasalized? These are some really interesting co-articulation, co-production questions that have not yet been explored that I think will yield some very interesting results. Based on the preliminary things that I've seen so far.
Great, thanks. We have another comment and a question from Richard Wright. He says, one of the things we saw back in the EPG days was the anticipatory and preservatory lateralization. Sometimes alternating materializers would alternate this. Do you observe this with clicks, like your Zulu speaker? He also writes, lateralization would sometimes span word boundaries and be several syllables away from the target. It's asymmetrical closures and releases of alveolar closures.
One thing that I have noticed is, one thing I have observed in the Zulu data, for example, was some interesting lateralization. I don't know if it's specifically what you're asking about, but in that study, what I looked at was clicks in symmetrical vowel contexts. So between E and E, between U and U, between A and A. And what was noticed is that for the Zulu speaker, and actually not for the Hadza speaker, but for the Zulu speaker, I did find that there was this lateralization occurring that we could actually hear acoustically, you know, auditorily, we could hear that there was this kind of lateralization between E and E, where it was like E, E, where it sounded almost like there was this lateral offset of the click, which was quite interesting. And I actually haven't explored as to why that may be or what was going on there. Perhaps I could get, you know, some of the literature that you're referring to that talks about this lateralization, because it may be relevant to that information or that data that I was observing, but not quite sure how to analyze.
Thanks. I'm curious if it's possible for anyone else who's interested in designing a study utilizing this technology, if it's possible to use the equipment that you guys have. Is there someone to contact about that?
Yes. So the answer, I guess, short answer is yes. Long answer would be, it kind of depends on what you wanted to do and what you mean by using it. Could you travel here to use it? I would assume that yes, of course, that would be allowed. And the person to contact there would be the head of the lab, who is Stephen Lulich. Lulich is L-U-L-I-C-H. And I'm sure that he would be happy to arrange something. If it was something that you would like to have someone else run the study for you and assist in that sense, then you know, I'd be willing to help coordinate something with you or help out in that sense as well. So, but definitely, I think that this is available for other people to use if they are interested, especially right now, because you know it's the only one, and so we'd like to be able to share that, of course.
Great, thanks.
And if you would like to contact me about that specifically, you can email me. My email is at the bottom of the screen as well.
Great. Well, looks like we don't have anything else right now. So I'll go ahead and announce the next webinar. So looking ahead, the next presentation in the webinar series will be given on Wednesday, September 9th by myself. And it's titled Bush to Town, Community-Based Research with the Hadza and Hanzu. I'd also like to remind everyone that recordings of all of the presentations in the Rift Valley webinar series can be found on the Rift Valley Network YouTube page, and entries for each presentation are added to the Rift Valley bibliography. All right, great. Well, I think that's probably it for now. So I want to thank you again, Jeremy, for your presentation, and I want to thank everyone else for participating today. I hope to see you all again at our next webinar in 2 weeks.